verse 105. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. Second one was from Isaiah 55, verse 11. So will my word be which goes out of my mouth. It will not return to me empty without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding in the purpose for which I sent it. Third one is Romans 15, verse 4. For whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction, so that through perseverance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope.
Thank you for the scripture readings this morning. Well, you know that for the past couple of weeks, I began a series of messages entitled Removing Them Rocks, Removing Them Intellectual Barriers and Blockages, which keeps us fully trusting in the Bible as the Word of God. Yeah, we want our faith to grow and to flourish, and so we want to move those away, the obstacles from the garden of our faith, so that will happen. As evidence is presented in a courtroom, various types of testimony is being presented week after week, which together will result in an overwhelming body of evidence that the Bible is the Word of God. True faith must be built upon the foundation of intellectually credible evidence. For many, the pathway to the heart is through the mind. Previous two messages, I think, can be summed up well by the search of evidence by Sir William Ramsay. A brilliant scholar with a PhD from Oxford, Ramsay is regarded as one of the greatest archaeologists who have ever lived. As an atheist early on in his career, Ramsay gave his life over to the pursuit of archaeology as a means to attempt to disprove the Bible. Over a century ago, he set out to the Holy Land on a mission to undermine the foundations of the Bible. However, 25 years of archaeological research, Sir William Ramsay uncovered hundreds of discoveries which only confirmed the accuracy of the Bible. And due to the overwhelming evidence that he discovered in one of his books, he shocked the world by declaring that the evidence had convinced him to become a Christian. Ramsay's journey went from atheism to Christianity based upon evidence. Okay. So let's approach the Bible with some healthy skepticism, but let's also be willing, as did Sir William Ramsay, be willing to follow the evidence where it leads. I personally spent over half of my life studying and examining the evidence for my faith. It's kind of my thing. My wife will attest, I always seem to have a book wherever we go, and I'm looking or reading about that type of material. And I am now more convinced than ever that the foundations of my faith are built upon the facts, and it's continued to propel me on the greatest adventure of my life, a transforming relationship with Jesus. Evidence for me was important that I might continue to grow as a Christian. And I'm confident this morning that as we look at the evidence, you too are going to grow in your faith and your love for God as we remove them rocks. So this morning, I want us to look at the evidence for the uniqueness of the Bible. Uniqueness of the Bible. How is the Bible different, and what separates the Bible from other religious books? Astrophysicist Hugh Ross, founding president of Reasons to Believe, he's author of many books, including The Fingerprint of God, and the creator and the cosmos, how the greatest scientific discoveries of the century reveal God. Some great books. In the introduction to Creator and the Cosmos, he describes what he calls a skeptical inquiry. In the section entitled Ruling Out Holy Books, he explains this. He said, I determined to investigate for myself the holy books of the world's major religions. I figured if God was the creator, was speaking through any of these books, and I presumed that he was not, then the communication would be noticeably distinct from what human beings would write. I chose history and science as good ways to test the revelations on these various religious, in these religious books. He said, in the first couple of holy books I examined, my initial hunch was confirmed. I found statements clearly at odds with established history and science. I also noticed a writing style is perhaps best described as esoteric, mysterious, vague. The sophistry and incongruity with established facts seemed opposite to the creator's character, as suggested to me by nature. He said, I was getting a little smug until I picked up the Bible. The book's distinctive struck me immediately. It was simple, direct, and specific. He said, I was amazed with the quantity of historic and scientific references and with detail in them. Instead of another bizarre creation myth, there was a journal-like record of the Earth's initial conditions. Correctly described from the standpoint of astrophysicists and geophysics, the account was simple, elegant, and scientifically accurate. Beginning that night, I committed myself to spend at least an hour a day going through the Bible to test the accuracy of all the statements of science, geography, and history. And then he said, at the end of 18 months, I was convinced that the Bible was supernaturally accurate and thus supernaturally inspired. And after a long evening of studying the salvation passages in the New Testament, I humbled myself before God, and at 1:06 in the morning, I signed my name to the back of my Bible, said it was a Gideon's Bible, stating that I have received Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Such was Hugh Ross's investigation as he recognized the evidence that the Bible was the unique Word of God. In our investigation of this morning, we will look at six categories, six areas of how the Bible is unique. First, the Bible is unique in its composition. The Bible is unique in that it was written over 1,500-year time span. Imagine that, 1,500 years. Written over 60 generations. Written by 40 authors from every walk of life. Moses was a political leader who was trained in the best universities in Egypt. Peter was a fisherman. Amos, a herdsman. Joshua, a military general. Jeremiah, a cupbearer, a high official in the royal court of the king. Daniel was a prime minister. Luke was a doctor. David, a warrior. Solomon, a king. Matthew, a tax collector. And Paul was a rabbi. The Bible is unique, written in different places. Moses in the wilderness, Jeremiah, well, he was in a dungeon, and Daniel on a hillside, and even in a palace. Paul inside prison walls. Luke, well, he was traveling, and John exiled on the island of Patmos. The Bible was written during different moods. Some wrote with the heights of joy, and others writing from the depths of sorrow and despair. The Bible was written on three different continents, in Asia, Africa, and Europe. Written in three languages, the Old Testament in Hebrew and in Aramaic, and the New Testament was written in Greek. We consider all of this, we quickly realize that the Bible is unique as compared to other religious books in its composition. Secondly, the Bible is unique in its circulation. The Bible has been read by more people, published in more languages than any other book. There has been more copies produced of its entirety and more portions and selections than any other book in history. There is absolutely no book that reaches or even begins to compare with the circulation of the scripture. Some 50 years ago, an author discovered that for the British in the Foreign Bible Society to meet its demands, it had to publish one copy every 3 seconds, day and night. That's 1,369 copies every hour, day and night. And that's 32,876 copies every day in the year. Doesn't in itself prove that the Bible is the Word of God, but it shows that its circulation is unique. Thirdly, the Bible is unique in its survival through persecution. Josh McDowell, the author of New Evidence That Demands a Verdict, he explains that the Bible has withstood various attacks of its enemies as no other book has. Many have tried to burn it, ban it, outlaw it. And from the days of, from the beginning, the Roman emperors to the present day, communist-dominated countries, they tried to destroy the Bible. In the 18th century, the famous atheist Voltaire, French writer, historian, and philosopher, is reported to have said that within 100 years, the Bible would be a forgotten book from his day. Strange twist of irony, that is in 100 years of Voltaire's death, one of his homes in France and his printing press would belong to the Geneva Bible Society. And it would serve as a place where the Bibles were printed and distributed. Voltaire passed into history. The circulation of the Bible, however, has continued to increase in almost all parts of the world. As noted Bible scholar Bernard Ram stated, 1,000 times over, the death knell of the Bible has been sounded. The funeral procession formed the inscription cut into the tombstone, but the corpse never stays put. The Bible is unique in its survival through persecution. Fourthly, the Bible is unique in its unity. As had been mentioned, the Bible consists of 66 books written by 40 different authors over a period of 1,500 years in three different languages, in three different continents, and yet miraculously it contains a unity of theme and teaching which makes it truly one book. In his book, Authority of the Bible, Jack Cortell says, within the pages of the Bible, a single main theme is being developed, the story of redemption, the drama of one great plan, a rescue operation. Despite its diversity, there is a single plot being worked out, and every section has a beginning, middle, and end. He says, the question that must be asked is this: how can we explain this remarkable unity? What could have caused it? He says we must rule out chance. It's obviously that an intelligent purpose or plan is involved. Could a human mind be behind this plan? The great time span rules that out. He says the unity of the message requires a single mind behind the whole thing, and no human being could have supervised the span of 1,500 years. He said, it's not just a story on paper, it's actually happened in history. It's the story it requires not just an author, but also a director who could actually bring these things to pass. The only satisfactory answer, he says, is that both the plan and the book are from one author of divine origin. Only the all-knowing, all-powerful God who transcends history, to whom 1,000 years is like a day, could have written this drama and then caused such a varied collection of writings to relate it as one story. World-renowned scripture scholar Dr. F.F. Bruce explains the unity of the Bible by saying, the writings themselves belong to a variety of literary types. They include history, civil, criminal, ethical, ritual, and sanitary laws, poetry, didactic treaties, lyrical poetry, parables, allegories, biographies, personal correspondence, personal memoirs, diaries, in addition to distinctly biblical types of prophecy. For all of that, the Bible is not simply an anthology, not simply a collection of writings, but there is a unity which binds the whole together. The Bible is unique in its unity. Fifth, the Bible is unique in its history of acts and facts. Dr. Henry Morris, in his book, Many Infallible Proofs, writes, alone among all the religions of mankind, Christianity is based upon historical acts and facts. Other religions are centered on ethical and religious teachings of their founders. But Christianity is built on great events of creation and redemption. Christianity is based on objective facts, not on the subjective. Its truth or falsity stands on the validity of written historical records of the Bible, which are subjected examined by ordinary criteria of objective investigation. The Bible is unique because its message, its contents, it's based upon historical acts and facts. And finally, this morning, we look at the Bible is unique in its content, the content of its message. In the book, Ready with an Answer, authors Ankelberg and Wenden explained the unique message of the Bible. They said that the Bible is the only religious scripture that offers eternal salvation as a free gift entirely by God's grace and mercy. Only the Bible begins with creation of the universe to the end of history. Only the Bible contains detailed prophecies about the coming of the Savior to the world, whose prophecies have proven true in history. Only the Bible has the most realistic view of human nature and the power to convict people of their sin and the ability to change human nature. Only the Bible has accurately been confirmed in history by archaeology. Only the Bible has withstood 2,000 years of intense scrutiny by critics, and it not only survived the attacks, but prospered and has had its credibility strengthened by such criticism. Only the Bible has molded the history of Western civilization more than any other book. Only the Bible proclaims a resurrection of the central figure proven in history. And only the Bible provides historic proof that the one true God loves mankind. The Bible. The Bible. It's unique in its composition, unique in its circulation, unique in its survival through persecution, unique in its unity, unique in its historical acts and facts, unique in the content of the message. After spending 42 years studying Eastern books, Professor Montero Williams, former Bowdoin professor, compared them with the Bible. And he said this, pile them, if you will, on your left side, on the study table, and place on its own the Holy Bible on its right, and then all by itself, the Bible, and there's a big and wide gap between them, for there is a gulf between it and the so-called sacred books of the East, which severs one from the other, utterly, hopelessly, and forever. A veritable gulf which cannot be bridged by any science of religious thought. As one person wrote of the Bible, century follows century, and there it stands. Empires rise and fall and are forgotten, there it stands. Dynasty succeeds dynasty, and there it stands. Kings are crowned and uncrowned, there it stands. Emperors decree its extermination, and there it stands. Atheists rail against it, and there it stands. The flames are kindled about it, there it stands. The tooth of time gnaws, but makes no dent in it, there it stands. Modernism has tried to explain it away, but there it stands. There it stands. As we had read earlier this morning in the scripture readings, Isaiah the prophet said, so will my word be. So will my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty without accomplishing that which I desire, and without succeeding in the manner for which I sent it forth. Indeed, the Bible is unique. As the Word of God, it has the power to change your life, transform your heart, impart faith, and bring you into a living, dynamic relationship with Jesus Christ. As God said, so will my word succeed, for which I have sent it forth. The word of God stands forever. Scripture here, as the grass dies and the flowers fail, the word of our God will live forever, Isaiah 40. It is the lamp unto our feet and the light to our path. Amen. Amen. I'm going to remain seated this morning. We prepare our hearts for communion, and we're going to sing the song, Thy Word is a Lamp Unto My Feet. And that will be our praise song chorus for this month. Word is a lamp unto my feet. A lamp unto my feet.
my guide, now hold me to your side, and I will love you to the
given to us. Thank you. Yes. Wonderful gift he's given to us, his word. Now this morning we're going to join together with communion, and those who are at home, you get your communion elements ready as we share as the people of God. You know, the unique and wonderful thing about the Bible is Jesus himself is called the Word of God, isn't he? He's called the Word. He came into the world. He was in the world, and he came into the world as the light of the world. He's the Word. He's the living Word. And it's through the written Word, as the Spirit breathes upon us, that we become into a closer relationship with the living Word. And so this morning, we understand that Christ came to the world to purchase, to redeem us. Next week in the book of Revelations, as you're studying that in the adult class, it says all heaven is rejoicing with all the angels, that worthy is the Lamb to be praised, to receive glory, honor, power, and majesty. For by your blood, by your shed blood, you purchased, you redeemed us. And I think that's such a wonderful thing. That our belonging to God isn't through all our struggles, isn't through all our efforts. We're not white-knuckled Christians just hoping, but we belong to God because of the power of the blood of Christ. We belong to him. We're his children. So this morning we come to the communion table and we celebrate what he has done for us. Scripture says, on the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ, he took the bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you. Whenever you do it, do this in remembrance of me." Let's take and eat, as I often will. Just be careful that you don't spill it, and take that first wrapper off. And we'll share in the body of Christ. And after supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Let us share in the cup together. Apostle Paul concludes the installation of the Lord's Supper by saying, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Amen. Let's stand, shall we, and join in our final hymn that we sing every communion Sunday.
Blessed be tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is life.